Hello everyone, I am Gyan and you are learning computer science with Python for class 11th. In this video, we are going to learn about different methods supported by dictionary data type in Python. We are going to learn dictionary functions and methods. The first function we are going to learn is the len function. We know that the len function is supported by various other data types. And of course, we can pass a dictionary variable or a dictionary literal to the argument of the len function. So let's use the len function practically and see its working. Let's create a dictionary D is equal to name colon John, salary colon 10,000, age colon 24. So, as you can see here, there are three elements in this dictionary. Element number 1, element number 2, and element number 3. All these three elements have their own key and own value. Key value. So, there are three elements in this dictionary, and all the elements have their separate key and a separate value. So, if I pass the dictionary variable to len method, it gives me number of elements in the dictionary, that is total three elements. If I type here again, D is equal to, say key is John and value is salary and age, salary colon 10,000 comma age colon 24. So here, whatever is present in this dictionary is just one element whose key is John and value is a complete dictionary having two elements inside this dictionary. The second element I am going to add is, say, Dia. Dia is the other element in which we have a salary, age 35,000 and age 30. So, this is my dictionary. Can you tell me how many elements this dictionary has? This dictionary has two elements. One is here and other one is here. So this dictionary has two elements. In the first element, key is John and the value is again a dictionary. In the second element, key is Dia and the value is again a dictionary. If you pass this dictionary to the method len, it will give you two because this dictionary has two elements. Now can you tell me what I get if I write here D, John, as an index? If I write D, John, as an index, I am going to get this dictionary as output. Press enter. So we have this dictionary as output. Can you tell me length of this dictionary? The length of this dictionary is 2. So here I can write len D, John, is 2 because this dictionary has only two elements in it. So hopefully you are getting the working of len method with dictionary. The next method we are going to learn is get method. How get method works? If you want a value of a given key, then you can use the get method. Of course, I can get the value of a key by using such indexing. But using the get method, I can also find value of a key. I can write here d.get and write the key here. The key, say Dia this time. Press enter and here I got the value corresponding to the key Dia. If I write here d.get and write a key which does not exist in this dictionary, then let's see what get method does. It shows nothing. Okay. If I try to access D1, it will throw a key error. Getting it? Because writing like this is equivalent to writing D dia. This is same. But if you provide a key to the get method which does not exist in this dictionary, the get method will keep silent and does not say anything. If you want this get method to say something in the occasion of non-presence of the key, then you have to call the get method in a different way. You need to call the get method like this: get, type here one, type here a key which does not exist, and write here key does not exist in D. Okay. So whenever a key is not found in the dictionary, the get method prints the string provided at the second argument of the get method. Press enter, and here we are. Since one was not found in the dictionary, the get method prints key does not exist in D. Otherwise, in case of accessing elements through indexing, if key does not exist, then Python directly throws an error and will stop your program from execution. So here in this situation, if you don't know that whatever key you are providing is going to exist in the dictionary or not, if you are not sure about this, you can use the get method instead of indexing. So what is formal format of the get method is, you can call the get method by using a dictionary literal or dictionary variable dot get, and inside the argument of get method you can provide a key, and then optionally you can provide a default string to print. This string will be printed if key does not exist in dictionary. So hopefully you are getting the working of get method. The next we are going to learn items method. Items method. Items method returns all the elements in dictionary as a sequence of key value tuples. Let's use it practically. Let's create a dictionary. EMP1 is equal to age 25, name is Bhuvan, salary is 20,000. This is my dictionary, and what I'm going to do here is I'm going to call the items method. Okay, let's call emp1 dot items method. Let's see the type returned by items method. emp1 dot items. The type is a class dictionary items. So you may need to convert this class to a list. Okay. Let me write here L is equal to list. Inside the list, you call emp1.items. As you can see, now we have a list of tuples. In every tuple of this list, one element is the key and other element is the value. One element is the key and other element is the value. One element is the key and other element is the value. So we have list of tuples, and in every tuple, one element is a key and other element is a value. This is what we are going to get. And I can write a for loop in order to print them one by one. For example, if I write for x in L, print x, and here you are, you have different elements of the list got printed one after another. You can also use the for loop like this. For x in, you can directly use emp1.items method here. emp1.items colon print x, and here you got the same output. So hopefully you are getting the meaning of items method, that how items method works with a dictionary. Notice here that x is a tuple here. X is a tuple. X is a tuple. X is a tuple here. What we can do here is, I can write for x comma y in emp1 dot items. Okay, for x comma y in emp1 dot items. What will happen? The key will be stored in x and the value will be stored in y, and further we can access both x and y separately. Okay, before to that, x contained the whole tuple having both key and value. Here x contains y and y contains value. Press enter, print x comma y. So I am printing x and y separately. Press enter, and here we got x has been printed followed by y. And if you want, you can just print x or just print y, or you can do different operations on x and y in separate. So emp1 dot items, I want to just print x, and here I got only keys. Okay, because x stores only keys. So this is what the items method is. Let's learn about another method that is called keys method. Keys method in Python. The keys method returns a list of keys in the caller dictionary. Let's use keys method practically. This is my dictionary and I want to get various keys present in my dictionary. So I can write here employ dot keys, and this gives me a list of keys in which I just have keys. Okay, of course the data type returned by keys method is of type dict keys, but I can apply this dict keys data type directly to for loop for x in employee.key colon print x, and it works. If you want to create a pure list data type from the keys method, then you can write something like that: l is equal to employee dot keys, and just pass it to the list method, and here you are. This is the list. So you can get a pure list, not a data type of dict keys, but you can get a pure list by passing the value returned by keys method to the list method. So hopefully you are getting it. We already have talked a lot about all these concepts in the previous videos of this series. The other method we are going to learn is values method. Values method. Values method returns list of values. Just like keys method, if I write employee dot values, it is going to give me different values as a list. Of course, this is again not a pure list. This is a data type of dict values. If you want to convert it to pure list, pass the method call as an argument to the list method, and you will get a pure list of values. Okay, similar to employees.keys, you can pass employee.values to for loop, and for loop will iterate over it. So hopefully you are getting it, and hopefully you are getting the meanings of keys and values method of dictionary data type in Python. The next method we are going to learn is from keys method. From keys method. So what from keys method does? फ्रॉम कीज मेथड क्रिएट अ डिक्शनरी आउट ऑफ गिवन कीज एज अ आर्गुमेंट टू द फ्रॉम कीज मेथड. सो यू विल बी गिवन अ सीक्वेंस ऑफ कीज यूजिंग विच यू हैव टू क्रिएट अ डिक्शनरी. बट हाउ? सो लेट्स यूज द फ्रॉम की मेथड प्रैक्टिकली. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल यू हैव टू कॉल फ्रॉम की मेथड यूजिंग अ स्पेशल ऑब्जेक्ट. दैट ऑब्जेक्ट इज कॉल्ड डिस्ट. ओके, यू हैव टू कॉल द फ्रॉम की मेथड बाय यूजिंग डिस्ट ऑब्जेक्ट. यू हैव नॉट क्रिएटेड दिस डिस्ट ऑब्जेक्ट. इट इज देयर इन पाइथन. यू हैव टू यूज इट. डिस्ट डॉट फ्रॉम कीज. एंड इनसाइड द फ्रॉम कीज यू हैव टू राइट सीक्वेंस ऑफ कीज. सीक्वेंस ऑफ कीज आइदर एज अ टपल और एज अ लिस्ट. राइट नाउ आई एम यूजिंग सीक्वेंस ऑफ कीज एज अ लिस्ट. सो राइट हियर 1, 2, 3, 4 दीज आर द कीज. इफ यू प्रेस इंटर यू आर गोइंग टू क्रिएट अ डिक्शनरी इन विच कीज आर वट एवर यू हैव प्रोवाइडेड इन द लिस्ट बट द वैल्यूज आर नन टू ऑल दीज कीज. सो यूजिंग दीज कीज यू हैव क्रिएटेड अ डिक्शनरी विथ नन एज अ वैल्यू टू ऑल द कीज. द फ्रॉम कीज मेथड कैन ऑल्सो बी कॉल्ड बाई यूजिंग अ वैल्यू आफ्टर द सीक्वेंस ऑफ कीज. द वैल्यू लेट्स सी इट इज हाई. सो यू आर गोइंग टू क्रिएट अ डिक्शनरी with all the keys are taken from the sequence but the values corresponding to all the keys are high. All the keys are having same values. If I write dist dot from keys and here if I use a list 1, 2, 3, 4 and I write a value like 5, 6, 7, 8 and you are thinking that you are going to create a dictionary with the keys as 1, 2, 3, and 4 whereas values will be 5, 6, 7, and 8 to all these four keys, then you are wrong. Let's see what type of dictionary we are going to create here. Here I am going to create a dictionary whose keys are 1, 2, 3, and 4, no doubt about it, but all these keys are having same value and that value is a list. List having four elements, 5, 6, 7, and 8. So here 5 has not been assigned to 1, 6 has not been assigned to 2. This is not happening here. But the whole list becomes a value of a given key. If I write here dict dot from keys and just write two tuples, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Press enter and again I got the same dictionary with number of keys are taken from the first tuple whereas the next element is a value. The complete next element is a value. Means the tuple 5, 6, 7 is a value to all the keys. Key arguments must be iterable in nature. Let me try something more. Dict dot from keys and if I write here 1, 2, 3, 4 as a string and write here hi as a value, press enter and again you can see 1, 2, 3, and 4 are taken from this string. And of course here the keys are also strings. Okay. But the strings of one character. So 1, 2, 3, and 4 are taken from the key string and all these keys are having same value, that is the value high. See, the first element of from keys method must be an iterator. That means it must be a data type which can be traversed by using for loop. If I write here dist dot from keys and right here 1, high, I'm going to get an error. Okay, because int object is not iterable. So if you want to create a dictionary having just one key, either you write 1 inside a list followed by the value which you want to assign to the list, or you write one inside a tuple. Okay, and I think you know how to create a one element tuple. So one inside a tuple and hi as a value, and I have written here dist. I had to write dist dot from key. So let's write it, dist dot from key, and provide one element tuple here, and this will work fine. So this is the from keys method. Hopefully you are getting it. Now let's see a formal format of from keys method. From keys method can be called by using dict object, which is readily available in Python. You should not have to care about it. Dist dot from keys, the one argument to from keys is a key sequence, either as a string or as a list or as a tuple. Key sequence. And other one is a value. Other one is a value which is optional. This is optional. If you do not provide a value, then a none will be assigned to all the keys created using from keys method. The next we are going to learn is set default method. Set default method. How set default method works? Let's see it's working practically. Suppose that I have a dictionary, marks is equal to 1 colon 350, 2 colon 423, 3 colon 411, 4 colon 300. So this is the marks. And what I'm going to do here is, I'm going to call set default method marks.setDefault, set default method, by using one argument as a key and other argument as a value. The key 5 is not present in the dictionary. Therefore, whatever the key you are providing will be added to the dictionary with the given value. Press enter. Type your marks, and here we have the key 5 has been added to the dictionary with the value 320. But let's do something more interesting. Marks.setDefault. Inside the argument, you pass the key 4 with the value 600. The key 4 with the value 600, and as you can see here, the key 4 is already present in this dictionary with the value 300. So if you press enter here and check marks here, you can see the value corresponding to 4 has not been changed to 600. Therefore, idea of the method setDefault is that if you call the setDefault method with a key which is not present in the dictionary, then key with its value will be added to the dictionary. And if you call the setDefault method which is already present in the dictionary, then key will not be updated with the new value. The old value will be retained for the given key. In the case when key was not present in the dictionary, at that time, whatever the value you are providing, that value will be returned by the setDefault method. But if the key is already present in the dictionary, then the older value, which already exists in the dictionary, will be returned by the setDefault method. And this is what the setDefault method is. If I call here the setDefault method, marks.setDefault, by using just one argument. So I'm just providing key. I am not providing any value. Press enter and check the marks. The key 6 got added to the dictionary with the value none. And here actually the setDefault method returns none which cannot be printed. The next we are going to learn is update method. Update method. First, let's see the use of update method practically. Let's create one dictionary. Employee 1 is equal to name John, salary 10,000, age 24. Then create another object. Employee 2 is equal to name Dia, salary 54,000, department DPT, sales. And you have created two dictionaries. Now let's call the update method by using employee 1. Employee 1 dot update. In argument you write employee 2. Employee 1 dot update employee 2. Press enter and see the changes in employee 1. Employee 1. Since we are calling employee 1 dot update employee 2, so employee 1 has to be updated according to employee 2. If a key got matched, then the value of employee 1 of that matched key will be updated according to employee 2. Therefore, name of employee 1 got updated according to employee 2, and name in employee 1 becomes Dia, whereas salary in employee 1 becomes 54,000 according to employee 2. The age is a unique key in the employee 1. It was not there in employee 2. Therefore, age retained itself in employee 1 with the value 24. The key DPT, the key department, was not present in employee 1. Therefore, the key department from employee 2 has been added to employee 1 with its values. So, if a key exists in both the dictionary, then the value in first dictionary will be updated according to second dictionary. That's what happened in the case of name and in the case of salary. But if a key is unique in a caller dictionary, then that key and its value will not be affected. Whereas if a key is a unique in argument dictionary, then that key will be added to the caller dictionary. So this is what's happening here. We are updating employee 1 according to employee 2. Calling the update method is actually similar to writing for key in new dictionary dot keys old dist key is equal to new dist key. So ultimately you are doing this thing where new dist key is employee 2 here, and old dist key should be updated according to new dist key. This is the update method. Hopefully you are getting it. The next method we are going to learn is shallow copy of a dictionary. That means the copy method. Copy method. Before we start learning about copy method, we must understand difference between shallow copy and deep copy. What I am talking here is shallow copy and deep copy. Now first let's understand about shallow copy. Suppose that I am creating a variable in Python called a is equal to 2. Okay, you know that what happens in the memory when I create such variables. I create a variable a which points to an object 2. Then if I write b is equal to a, then actually I am creating a variable b which is also pointing to 2. Getting it? Okay, that means id of a is going to be same as id of b. both would be same, because here I am copying the content of A in content of B. This type of copy is called a shallow copy. Shallow copy. What happens after that? If I change the value of B to 3, then B will stop pointing to 2 and start pointing to somewhere else, that is 3. This is the shallow copy. Okay. So when A and B both are pointing to same object, because of this copy operation, because I was assigning the content of A in content of B, so because of this copy operation, whatever happened in the memory, that is called a shallow copy. But what is a deep copy? What is a deep copy? Deep copy means, suppose that you have A is equal to 2 and you write B is equal to A. If it is a deep copy, then what is going to happen here is, you have A which is pointing to object 2 and you have B which is pointing to a different object but with the same content 2. If because of writing this one, something like this happened in the memory, then this process is called a deep copy. But here Python does not support a deep copy in this case. Python only supports a shallow copy in this case. Got it? Okay. Now let's see what happens with dictionary. Suppose that I have a dictionary STU. STU is equal to 1, Neha, 2, Saima, 3, Avneet, 4, Anna. This is my dictionary. Now let's see what actually happens in memory when you create a dictionary. You are going to have a dictionary object. You are going to have a dictionary object with how many elements are there? There will be total 4 elements. So you are going to have total of 4 elements. 1, 2, 3 and 4. Each element is going to be divided into 2 parts. One for the key and other for the value. So this is your dictionary object. Dictionary object. And this dictionary object is pointed by a variable STU. Hopefully you know the meaning of pointing. Pointing means the address of this object will be contained inside the variable STU. Further, in the first element, this is the element number E1. This is the element E2. Okay. This is the element E3. And this is the element E4. So you have 4 elements inside the dictionary object. The key part of element 1 is pointing to 1. And the value part of element 1 is pointing to Neha. The key part of element 2 is pointing to 2. Whereas the value part is pointing to Saina. Similarly, the key part of element 3 is pointing to 3, whereas value part is pointing to Avneet. The key part of the fourth element is pointing to 4. The value part of the fourth element is pointing to Anna. So these are the 4 elements you have. The key part is pointing somewhere and the value part is pointing to somewhere else. This is the dictionary in memory. So if I'm going to create a variable STU2 and I write STU2 is equal to STU, then what happens in the memory is I'm going to create a new variable STU2 which points to the same object where STU is pointing. This is the shallow copy. This object has 2 names now. One is STU and other one is STU2. So if you update STU and you write STU1 is equal to Priya, then the data part of element 1 will start pointing to Priya rather than Neha. Okay. And as you can see here, STU is pointing to same object, whereas STU2. So if you print STU2, 1, you will get Priya as the output. So here the change made by the variable stu also got visible by the variable stu2. This is one kind of shallow copy. Okay, hopefully you are getting the concept. I have changed something which was pointed by both the objects. This is a kind of shallow copy. Let's try this situation practically. STU is equal to 1 Neha, 2 Saina, 3 Avneet, 4 Anna, 5 Taru. If I write here STU, this is my dictionary. Let's type STU2 is equal to STU. Now both are pointing to same object. Okay, both are pointing to the same dictionary object. Type ID STU and ID STU2. Both are pointing to the same dictionary object. Now if I write STU 1 is equal to Priya. I want to change the name Neha to Priya. Okay. Press enter, type STU, and here the name got changed. But interestingly, if I type STU 2, the name got changed for STU 2 also. Because both are pointing to the same dictionary object. So change made by one name will be also affected by the other name, because both are ultimately pointing to the same object. Both are two different names of the same object. As you have seen in this picture, both are pointing to the same dictionary object. So the changes made by one name will also be affected to the other name. So this is the situation when you create a copy of dictionary by using assignment operator. Now let's use the copy method to create a copy of dictionary, and here we will have a different situation. If I write here STU2 is equal to STU.copy. So what happens here is I am going to create one more object. Let me take this one below this picture. Okay. If I write STU2 is equal to STU.copy, then what is going to happen here is I am going to create another dictionary object. Means I am not going to point the same dictionary object. That means STU2 is not going to point the same dictionary object, but a new dictionary object will be created with four elements inside it. The number of elements is going to be same as the number of elements pointed by STU. Since this dictionary object has four elements, therefore this dictionary object will also have four elements. Now, what we are going to do, again, these four elements will be divided into two parts, one for key and other for value. This is the element 1, this is the element 2, this is the element 3, and this is the element 4. STU2 will point to the newly created object. STU2 will point to the newly created object. Now, key part of the element 1 will point to the same object where key part of element 1 from the older dictionary object was pointing. Similarly, this one will point here. This one will point here. This one is going to point here. This one is going to point at this place. This one is going to point at this object. The key here of the element 4 is going to point at this object. Value of the element 4 will be pointing to this object. So these are the values which are pointed by various elements of the created dictionary. So if you print STU you will get this data, and if you print stu2 again, you will get the same data. It is looking like both the variables are pointing to the same dictionary object, but this is the actual situation we have. Now let's change the value of the element e1 from Neha to Priya. Right here, stu1 is equal to Priya. What happens here in the memory? E1 stops pointing to Neha and starts pointing at some other object with content Priya. And this change at the older dictionary object does not affect newer dictionary object. The value part of element 1 in newer dictionary object is still pointing to Neha. Getting it? So if you change something by using one variable, that will not be affected to other variable. The value part of e1 is still pointing to Neha. The stu2 1 is still pointing to Neha, but stu1 now is now pointing to Priya. This one is still pointing to Neha, but this one starts pointing to Priya. So changes made by one variable does not make any effect on other variable. This is the situation. Now let's try it practically. So this is my dictionary whose reference is stored in the variable stu. I'm going to create another variable stu2 is equal to stu.copy. Using the copy method, I'm going to create a new dictionary object whose reference will be stored in stu2, and situation is like this. Stu is pointing to this object, whereas stu2 is pointing to this object. Okay. Now, if I write here stu, as you can see, the dictionary has been printed. If I write here stu2, the same dictionary has been printed. If I type id stu, then as you can see, I'm pointing to a location. Now, if I type stu2 in id method, then I'm pointing to a different location. So both the variables are pointing to different locations right now. But if I write something like that, stu3 is equal to stu, then I type id stu3. As you can see, stu and stu3 is pointing to the same location, means on the same object. But stu3 is not our consideration. What we are considering is stu and stu2. And as we can see here, both are pointing to different locations, but both are having same content. Now let's change the content of stu. Like stu1 is equal to Priya. So I want to change the value Neha to value Priya. Press enter, type stu. The one got updated to Priya. Whereas if I type stu2, the one at stu2 is still pointing to Neha, as you can see in this situation. Now let's consider another situation. Suppose that the value 1 here in stu is not pointing to Neha. Suppose that it is pointing to a list whose 4 elements are N, E, H and A. Let's try it. Suppose that the object pointed by E1 was not a string but was a list. Okay. Suppose that this was a list having 4 values in E, H, A. Neha. Okay. And of course, E1 from stu2 is also pointing to Neha. Got it? Now, if I write stu1 dot append say L. Okay, stu1 dot append L. A new L will be added to the existing object. Okay, stu dot append L, then a new L will be added to the existing object. Actually, you are updating the object. The list data is a mutable data and you are updating the list data. So that update in the data will be also affected by the stu2. Okay, this update will be also seen through the variable stu2. See, if you try to change a complete object, then the value part of e1 will stop pointing to this object and will start pointing to a new object. But here you are not changing a complete object, you are updating the object. And since you are not changing a complete object, you are just updating an object, then in this case, the updation will be visible through stu and stu2 both. So if you are using here a mutable data and you update the object, then that updation will be visible by both the variables. Even if you are using the copy method, let's try it. Instead of creating such dictionary, let me create a dictionary which is having a list here attached with the key 1. So I have a list whose content is n, e, h and a. Good. Now what I'm doing here is I'm writing stu2 is equal to stu dot copy. Press enter and here it is. Okay, and this is my stu. Now let's do something interesting. Let's write stu1 dot append. stu1 dot append, and I am going to append L to the list pointed by the value of the first element. Press enter, and if I type stu, as you can see, a L has been appeared in this object. Now if I type stu2, as you can see, a L has been appeared in this object too because of this region. E1 from this dictionary was pointing to this object. E1 from this dictionary was also pointing to this object. And we are not changing the object. Okay, by writing stu2.append L, we are not changing the object. We are updating the object. And that update will also be visible by stu2. If we have changed the object, then this E1 was started pointing to somewhere else, but we are not changing the object, we are updating the object. That's why the change was also visible by stu2. This is another example of cello copy. Now you may ask, what do I mean by a deep copy? A deep copy means I have a dictionary which is pointing to say somewhere. Okay, somewhere different objects. If I have a copy mechanism using which I am going to create another dictionary which exactly starts pointing to a very different object, not at the same object, then this situation is called a deep copy. Okay, learning about deep copy is beyond the scope of your syllabus. So hopefully you understood the meaning of cello copy, deep copy, and what happens actually using copy method. Next, we are going to learn about pop method. Pop method. Let's use the pop method practically. Suppose that I have a dictionary, stu is equal to 1, Neha, 2, Saima, 3, अवनीत, फोर अना. So this is the dictionary I have pointed by the variable stu. Now, if I want to remove an element from this dictionary, I will call stu.pop method with a key which should be removed from the dictionary. So the provided key with its value, that means the whole element will be removed from the dictionary. Press enter and as you can see, the value corresponding to the provided key will be printed, will be returned by the method pop. And if you check the content of dictionary now, as you can see, the element 4 Anna has been removed from the dictionary. Now you suppose that you want to remove content from this dictionary whose element is 6. So 6 is not present as a key in this dictionary. Therefore, in this case, Python will throw an error, that is key error. If you want the Python to not throw any error in the case of a key is not present, for that you need to call the pop method in a different way. Type here 6 and type here the value which you want your pop to return if the key is not found. Okay, so write here the value, key not found. Here my value is a string literal. So if 6 is not found, then the string literal will be returned by the pop function. Press enter and here we are. And instead of throwing a key error, the pop method has returned the string key not found. If I write here stu.pop, type here 6, comma, instead of using a string variable, if I write here a fractional number 2.3. So in the case where key 6 is not found in the dictionary, 2.3 will be returned by the pop method. So whatever the value you provide here as the second argument of pop method, that value will be returned if the key is not found in the dictionary. If you do not provide any value here like this and a key is not found in the dictionary, in this case your program will stop execution in abnormal way. So this is the pop method. You can also write here stu.pop 6, none. So if 6 is not found in the dictionary, nothing will be returned by the pop method. And even the pop method will not cause any error, will not cause any abnormal termination of your program. If you look at carefully at the format of pop method, then pop method can be called like dictionary.pop key, comma, and a value in case of error. In case of key not found, return it. In case of key not found in dictionary, return it. So this is your pop method. Hopefully you are getting it how the pop method works. The next we are going to learn is pop item method. Pop item method. Pop item removes an item from the dictionary which was last added in the dictionary. Pop item removes a complete item, that means a complete key value pair in the form of a tuple. Let's use the method pop item practically in order to understand its working. Can you tell me which item was added last in this dictionary? So when you create a dictionary by writing all its elements, then which element is written at last? That element was added last to the dictionary. Since this element already has been removed by using the pop method, therefore now the latest last element is 3 Avneet. Therefore, when I call stu.popItem, I will get a tuple whose key is 3 and value is Avneet. Here, these are the remaining elements in the dictionary. The element 3 Avneet has been removed from the dictionary. The other method we are going to learn is clear method. So clear method removes all the elements from the dictionary and make it empty. If I write here stu dot clear, if I type stu, the content of the dictionary got erased and we are remaining with an empty dictionary. Notice here that we are not deleting the dictionary object. We are not deleting the dictionary object. What we are doing, we are just erasing the content of dictionary object. And that's what we are doing. In order to delete a dictionary object, what we have to do, we have to write del followed by the variable name. And this deletes the dictionary object permanently from the memory. Okay. We already have used the del method in the previous videos in this series. The next we are going to learn is sorted method. We already have used sorted method with list and with tuple. And now let's use the sorted method with dictionary. Say we have a dictionary, stu is equal to 41 Neha, 12 Saima, 32 Avneet, 24 Anna, 15 Saji. So we have this dictionary. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to call the sorted method with dictionary as its input. Press enter, and as you can notice here, we got a list of keys and the elements of this list are in sorted order. This is the working of sorted method with dictionary. If you want the sorted method to return a list in reverse sorted order, stu comma reverse is equal to true. In this case also, the sorted method will return a list of keys. The elements of this list will be arranged in descending order. So this is the working of sorted method. In order to sorted method to work, all the keys should be comparable. Getting me? That means if I create a list something like this and one of the element say is tuple, all the keys in this dictionary are in integer, but one key in this dictionary is a tuple. Press enter, and then you call sorted with stu as its argument. See, in order to sort the keys should be comparable. Comparable means we should know that which one is greater than other and which one is less than other. But a number cannot be compared with a tuple. Therefore, in this case, the sorted method will throw an error that tuple and integer cannot be compared. So if I write here stu is equal to and provide different tuples here, 15, 13, 12, 2, 5, 7, and 8, 9. If I create a list like this and pass it to the sorted method, I get the list of tuples in sorted order. Okay. Means the keys should be comparable in order to sorted method to work with a dictionary. We know that stu.keys gives list of key, and if you pass stu.keys in sorted method, then you got a list in ascending order. Okay, So effect of sorted STU is same as effect of sorted STU dot keys. If you want the values to be sorted, then you get the list of values by using STU dot values and pass it to the sorted method. Pass it to the sorted method. Press enter, and here you got all the values are sorted in this list. Next, we are going to learn age max method. Max method. So this is my dictionary STU. If I pass this dictionary to the max method, then I will get the maximum key. Which key is maximum? The key 1513 is maximum key. When we pass a variable of type dictionary to the max method will return the maximum key. Of course, a key can be supposed to be maximum only if all the keys are homogeneous, means all the keys are comparable. If you have a dictionary like this, in which a tuple cannot be compared with a string, that means all the keys are not homogeneous, then in that case, max method will not work. If I type your max STU, it will not work and throw an error. Okay, so max method will work only if the keys are comparable. That means the keys are homogeneous. Similar to max method, you have something called min method. Let's copy it. Paste it. You have something called min method. If you pass the dictionary STU to min method, then it will return the minimum key. Here the minimum key is 2, 3. Okay, this is the minimum key. Similarly, let's copy this dictionary, paste it here, and right here say 54. Pass the dictionary STU to min method and it returns the minimum valued key. After that, you have something called sum method. Sum method. If you pass a dictionary to the sum method, then it adds all the keys and returns their summation. So all the keys are added together to return their summation. Now suppose that this is my dictionary where all the keys are tuple. Let's copy it and paste it here. Pass it to the sum method, sum STU, press enter. It says that this is an error. Let me create one more dictionary. D is equal to, the key is the string A followed by say 34. Key is the string B followed by say 37. Okay, pass it to the sum method, sum D. Press enter. Again it says unsupported operand type. That means sum method will work only if the keys are numbers. Okay, otherwise it will not work. Let me create the dictionary in another way. Paste it here. Right here 3.4 3.7, press enter, sum D, and here we got the two numbers, the two keys have been added. So in order to the sum method to work, the keys should be in numerical form, in the arithmetic form. It will not work with tuples or strings as keys. So the two more methods we have learned, one is min and other one is sum. Hopefully you are now comfortable with all the methods supported by dictionary data type in Python. Hopefully you enjoyed this video. See you in the next video.